Hello again. In the long run, the entire energy supply will need to become sustainable, but we are still far away from this target. What can we do about it? Most renewable energy technologies are not yet cost competitive. Their average cost per megawatt hour is higher than the wholesale market price for electricity. An important reason is that the social costs of CO2 emissions are not reflected in the electricity price. A second investment barrier is that technologies such as wind, solar, hydro, and geothermal energy are highly capital intensive. This means that most of the costs are made upfront, causing higher investment risk than, for instance, for a gas plant, given the uncertainty of future electricity prices. So how can we attract more investment in renewable energy technologies? Policymakers have a choice between price and quantity instruments. Investment in renewable energy can be stimulated through subsidies, increasing the price they receive, or a requirement can be implemented to build a certain volume of renewable energy generators, a quantity target. First, we will discuss three price instruments: feed-in tariffs, feed-in premiums, and subsidy auctions. A feed-in tariff guarantees producers of renewable energy a fixed price per unit of supplied electricity. This price needs to be high enough to cover the total cost of generation, or else no one would invest. The fixed price removes uncertainty about the renewable generator's revenues. In a typical case, the electricity price will be too low to cover the total cost of a renewable energy generator, let's say a wind farm. Of course, it operates when it can because its variable costs are very low. An intermediary company, such as a network or a retail company, buys the renewable energy and sells it at market value. The difference is the subsidy. This can be paid directly by the government. Another option is to finance the subsidy with a levy on the electricity price. Germany, Spain, and Denmark, among others, used feed-in tariffs to achieve their fast growth in renewable energy. Feed-in tariffs may pose a challenge to the government because the subsidy budget is difficult to manage. The cost of renewable energy is difficult to predict. If the feed-in tariff is higher than the cost, everyone will want to invest. While if the tariff is too low, it has no effect. A related concept is a feed-in premium. Let's consider the same market price development as before. Instead of providing a fixed total income per megawatt hour, the government now provides a fixed premium that will be paid to producers of renewable energy on top of the electricity market price. So now the renewable energy generator's revenues are equal to this market revenues plus this fixed premium. What are the differences with a feed-in tariff? The government has more control over the subsidy budget. Regardless of the market price, it always pays the same amount. As for the producers, however, they now have price risk, as it is not guaranteed that the sum of the subsidies and the market price are sufficient to cover all their costs. In the case of very low market prices, they may make a loss. On the other hand, if market prices are really high, the government will compensate them beyond what is necessary. This uncertainty is one of the major shortcomings of fixed premiums. A challenge for both tariffs and premiums is that the volume of subsidies increases with the share of renewables. An alternative approach is the Dutch policy, which auctions subsidies. The government tenders a certain generation capacity per renewable energy technology, like wind, solar, biomass. Producers offer proposed renewable energy projects at the expected cost level. The subsidy is then awarded to the projects that require the least subsidy per unit of electricity that they supply. For parties that have been awarded a subsidy, it works similarly to a feed-in tariff. The subsidies cover the difference between the costs and market revenues. This mechanism selects the most cost-efficient renewable energy project for support. Therefore, it provides renewable energy project developers with a strong incentive to reduce their costs. A second advantage is that the government maintains more control over the subsidy budget as it decides how much renewable energy generation capacity it purchases. So it is a combination of a price and a quantity instrument. A pure quantity-based instrument is a renewable energy portfolio standard. In this case, the government defines a binding target, for instance, a percentage of total consumption that must be supplied with renewable energy. Typically, this target applies to consumers, which means that they must buy a certain share of renewable energy. A market for renewable energy certificates allows consumers or retail companies on their behalf to buy the required renewable energy from producers. So how does such a market for renewable energy certificates work? The demand is set by the government. This is the Renewable Energy Portfolio Standard, say the share of renewable energy in final consumption. This demand is fixed, and therefore we display it as a vertical line. When a supplier generates renewable electricity, he receives a certificate from the government which it may offer to the certificate market. By selling these certificates, the producer receives extra income in addition to the sale of electricity. In theory, producers offer their certificates at a price that covers the difference between the market price and their average generation costs, for otherwise they would not recover their investments. This results in a supply curve like this. The most expensive renewable energy technology, for instance biomass in Western Europe, sets the certificate price. A disadvantage is that this results in higher than necessary revenues for the cheaper renewable energy technologies. These windfall profits should lead to more investment in these technologies, but often there are permitting restrictions, for instance in the case of onshore wind. A second issue with a renewable portfolio standard is that the total annual renewable energy production of wind, solar, and hydro varies from year to year. In a year with lower supply, there may not be many options left for meeting the demand for renewable certificates, and the price may jump. Conversely, the price may drop in years with ample output. This price uncertainty reduces the attractiveness of investing in renewable energy, which is the objective of the policy instrument. Let's recap what we have learned. Most forms of renewable energy need subsidy, at least right now. The government has different objectives when designing a renewable energy policy instrument. Of course, the primary goal is to stimulate renewable energy. To this end, it is important to reduce the risk of investing in renewable energy. On the other hand, the government wants to keep control over its budget. A second trade-off is between producing renewable energy as cheaply as possible, for instance, by focusing on only the cheapest technologies, versus spending money on other technologies as well, because they may be needed in the longer term. A final issue is that renewable energy policies are implemented at the national level. However, climate change is an international issue, and it is more economically efficient to tackle the challenges together. For instance, if green certificates can be purchased from producers abroad, the market may work a lot better. I hope this gave you a good first overview of the different policy options, their potential, and their limitations. Good luck with the exercises, and I'll see you in the next lecture.